So I want to thank the organizers for the invitation. So I'm part of the group who's for the first time in Rio, and actually I'm having a great time. So I'm supposed, I think, to give the opening act for the talks this afternoon. So I was asked to give an introduction to spaces of arc. So the interesting part will come in the afternoons when you hear Maria and Roy talk about the Nash problem. But what I want to do, I want to give an introduction to the what these spaces are, and especially emphasizing the connection with birational geometry. So somehow, I hope that you'll see somehow why these objects are naturally related with birational geometry. So in particular, I want to introduce the Nash problem. Okay, so let me start. So I think in this part, I always assume that we work, so X will be a scheme of finite type over some algebraically closed field. And as you'll see, it will be important in the first talk that I assume that the characteristic of the ground field is zero. For one reason, this is because I want to use the resolution of singularities. But in fact, some of the results are really rely heavily on the characteristic zero assumption because of generic smoothness. All right, so of course, we all remember Zariski's notion of tangent vectors, right? So a tangent vector to a point, so if x is a point in x, right? So a tangent vector, I guess, let's say the tangent space at x, right, consists of all maps spec k of t mod t squared to x, such that the point, right, I guess, the unique point goes to x. All right, so what these arc spaces and jet spaces are some sort of higher order versions of this notion of tangent space. So an M jet on X is a ski map from spec K of T mod T to the M plus 1 to X, right? So in particular, when M is equal to 0, this is just a point in X. When M is equal to 1, it's a tangent vector, and so on. And an arc on X is a limit of such gadgets. So it's a map from spec of the formal power series ring in one variable to X. Okay, now the thing to note is that this object on the left, right, has two points. So one is the closed point that I usually write 0, and one, the generic point, 8. All right, so of course, we all think of this sort of gadgets as really some sort of I guess, if you want, some formal version of some analytic arc on the variety. But from the algebraic point of view, right, so this really has just two points. All right, so the main object is this jet scheme, which is, so if, let's say, M is non-negative integer, X is above, so the mth jet scheme, which I'll write as jmx of x. Also, it's characterized. Also, in order to, so I want to really define it as a scheme, not as a, just as a set. So if you want to describe a scheme, right, you have to say what are the r-valued points of jmx. Right? So you have hom from spec r to jmx. So this should be in natural bijection to the set of R of T mod T to the M points of X itself. All right, so this characterizes the functor of points for the Mth jet scheme. So in particular, right, so if you look just at usual K-valued points, I mean, as a set, if, well, let's say K-valued points of J Mx correspond, so they're in bijection to M jets on X. So it's actually very easy. Also, I mean, if you want, you can think of this, I mean, if you like fancy stuff, right, you can think of this as some sort of moduli space of certain, right, maps between K of T mod T to the M plus 1 and X. But unlike other Hom schemes that actually take quite a bit of work to construct and to describe. These are very easy. So maybe the first proposition. Well, maybe I'm not going to state as a proposition. Also, JMX exists. And let me sketch the construction. Because one advantage is that the construction already tells you actually how to compute it. So I'll just deal with the case when X is affine. So say X is spec, so you embed it in some affine space, let's say Xn, modulo a bunch of equations or some alphas. Right, so then what are you trying to parameterize, right? So if I want an R-valued point of GMX, I have to construct a map from KX1 Xn mod this ideal F alphas to R of T mod T to the n plus 1. Right, but of course, how do you describe such a map? Right, so this is equivalent with saying where each Xi goes, right, in here, and then you have some conditions that F alpha should go to 0. Right, so let's say this is phi. Right, so I have to tell you that phi of Xi is sum of Aij x to the j, t to the j, where j goes from 0 up to n. Right, and then if you write F alpha, F phi of x1, phi of xn, right? So this has some expansion in terms of the aijs, right? So this is, I'll write as the sum, j from 0 up to n, of something that I write f, j, so this is of all these a's, right, times t to the j. Right, so this is for every, I guess, f alpha, for every alpha. Right, so you get such expansion where these are just some polynomial expressions in the A's. All right, so then it's clear that parameterizing such maps, basically you have to give values to the Aij's such that these guys vanish. All right, so the conclusion is that J M of X is isomorphic to spec. All right, so now you have a bunch of variables that I'll write Xi Bj, and such that you have F alpha 1, F alpha n, right, for all alpha have to vanish. Okay, so this is, so not only that it exists, but for example, you have very explicit equations in the case when X is affine. And when X is not necessarily affine, X is not affine, just glue the construction for affine chart. For affine charts. Okay? All right, so this is about existence. So now let's deduce just from the definition a few basic properties. So let's stare a little bit at the definition, right? So first of all, it's functorial, right? So we get a functor. So if you map X to JMX, so this is a functor, a covariant functor, right? Simply because if you have a map from X to Y, you get an induced map from JMX to JMY, which I'll write FM, right? So this is, again, how do you describe such a map, right? If I have an R-valued points of JMX, I have to get an R-valued points of JMY, but basically I just compose the corresponding map to X with a map from X to Y, right? So, I mean, basically, again, you have an arc mapping to X, you just compose it with a function. All right, so second, we get some natural projections. So if, let's say if M is larger than P, we have some truncation maps, right? So you have a closed embedding from spec R of T mod R, let's see, so I guess from T to the P plus one embedded in spec R of T mod T to the M plus one, right? So this is, if you think of the map at the level of rings, right, this is just truncation, the obvious projection. So this is a closed embedding. So in particular, if I have, did I mess up? That's right. So if I have an M jet, if I have a map from this one to X, right, by composition, if I just restrict to this subscheme, I get a P jet on X. All right. So this is induced by truncation. So we get a map, a projection map that goes from JMX to JPX. Right, and of course they are compatible. So if I go farther to some JQX, the composition is just the projection from JMX to JQX. So you get a tower of maps. Say JMX maps to JM minus 1X, and so on up to when you get to J1X, and then to J0X, which is simply just X. All right, and as I said, J1X, this is just the total tangent space of X. OK? So now one thing that comes out of the construction, right, is that if I choose an affine open subset of X, so let's say if X is affine, right, so all of these guys are affine. So in particular, in fact, all these maps are affine maps. I mean, strictly speaking, for this, I have to say one more thing, that if I have an open subset of X, if I take the inverse image, I just get the jet scheme for the corresponding subset. Right? So let me state this. Also, if I look at, so this would be the third property, so JMX mapping to X, and if I have U open subset, so let's say this, maybe I'll write this is pi m. So pi m inverse of U is isomorphic to J. Okay, so this is maybe one of the first things that you prove. For example, in order to glue things on affines, you'll want to know this property. But this just follows by definition, right? So I mean, it's pretty trivial to check, right? So if you have an arc that lies on X, but if it's contained in the open subset, of course it's an arc on the open subset. Maybe slightly less trivial, but which follows immediately from the description in terms of equations is that if you have X inside Y, a closed embedding, closed immersion, then in fact the induced map from JMX to JMY is also a closed immersion. Right? And this is because we've seen locally how to get equations, right? So basically from one equation for X in Y, I guess if I embed Y in some affine space, right, I construct the equations for JMY starting from those equations. If I have more equations that cut out also X, I just add those equations, corresponding things for JMX. All right, so this follows from the local description. All right, so now let's look at one special case. Right, so the easiest case, which was implicitly used in this construction, is the case when X is the affine space. So then X is the spectrum of a polynomial ring. So then as we've seen, in fact, JMX, right, is simply an affine space of dimension n plus 1 times n. And the corresponding map, JM minus 1X, right, is just projection onto the first MN component. So this is the picture for the affine space, but then if you have something which is smooth, not necessarily the affine space, you get a very similar picture. So more generally, so if X is smooth, and let's say U inside X is open, such that we have a system of coordinates x1, xn on U. So then if you look at the projection from Jmx to X, and if you look at what happens on U, so this is in fact isomorphic to U times an affine space of dimension m times n. Right, because how do you get an arc over a point in U? Right, again, you have to specify the point in U, and then you have to say where each of the coordinates goes, right? But it's supposed to go now in T mod T to the m plus 1. So this gives this isomorphism over here. Right, and if you go, so the projection, Jm minus 1, U is isomorphic to U times A M minus 1, and again, this is simply the projection onto the first components. All right, so one thing that follows right away is that at least in the, so when X is smooth, the picture is very simple. Right, you can so in particular, so if X is a smooth variety, let's say of dimension n, each projection map, if you go from Jmx to Jpx, is locally trivial in the Zariski topology with fiber and affine space of dimension m minus p times n. And in particular, if I go from Jmx all the way to X, this is right locally trivial with a fiber A times mn. So in particular, Jmx is itself a smooth variety of dimension m plus 1 times. All right, so that's about jet schemes. So now let's look at this tower, right? So again, so I have this tower of maps which are all affine. So this is one case in which we know that we can take the projective limit of the system, right? Because you remember that in general, if you have, I mean, a family of maps, right, it's a bit tricky in the context of schemes to take the projective limit. But in this case, it's very easy because you just do it locally over X. You choose one open subset. The corresponding, if you, I take the inverse image, they are all affine maps. And then you just take spectrum of the direct limit of the corresponding rings. All right, so
let's do that.
So then you get the space of arcs of X. Is J infinity X. So this is the projective limit of Jmx. Right, again, explicitly, if X is affine, right, so the ring of OJ infinity X is simply the direct limit of O of Jmx. All right, so if you think about how projective limits behave with respect to taking functors of points, so certainly you'd expect that if I take the R-valued points is J infinity x. So this should be home from spec, I guess this is spec R, from spec R of T to x. So this, in fact, it's true, but it's actually pretty hard to prove. So I think Bargov-Bott gave an argument for this. On the other hand, for what we want, so this is easy, for example, in the important case when R is a field, and more generally, if it is a local ring. I mean, the subtlety comes from the fact, of course, if x is affine, this is trivial, right? But the trouble is that, well, if you have a morphism from spec R to J infinity x, it's a bit tricky to reduce to the affine case, right? So this is trivial to do when, for example, you map from spec of a field, because then you just, everything happens at one point, and just you choose just some affine neighborhood. But anyway, so mostly we are interested in actually k-valued points, right? So basically arcs, so k-valued points on J infinity are really arcs on x, right? So let me emphasize. So in particular, k-valued points of J infinity x are in bijection to arcs. I mean, in fact, for almost everything I'm going to say, you can just reduce to the case when x is affine. So that's not a big loss. All right. Of course, you can also make this into a functor. So you get a functor which takes x to J infinity x and f to total right f infinity. All right, so the main issue is how what kind of properties can you see at the level of the space of arcs, at the level of jet schemes. All right, so what I'll talk about in the rest of this talk and in the second one are various issues concerned with how can you see actually the singularities, information about the singularities of x in terms of the space of arcs or in terms of the space of jets. All right, so now let's start actually proving something. All right, so basically I want to explain one very elementary connection to birational geometry. So it comes from very simple fact. So let's say proposition one. So say that f from y to x is a proper birational morphism. So from now on, most of the objects I'm going to talk about are varieties. So varieties. Such, so it's birational, such that, and let Z inside X be closed, of course, different from the whole X, such that F is an isomorphism over X minus Z. Okay? So you just choose some open subset such that F is an isomorphism over this open subset. So then the assertion, so then the map that goes from, So I have the map from J infinity y to J infinity x, which is F infinity. So inside in here, I'm going to throw out the arc space of Z. So I have J infinity x minus J infinity Z. And I take the inverse image of this one, right? So these are arcs such that when I, on x, they are not completely contained in Z. So this means that over here, the inverse image is J infinity Y minus F inverse of J infinity
get this map over here.
Right, so the assertion is that this map, right, so this here is a bijection. Furthermore, well, since these are infinite dimensional spaces, I have to be a little careful, right? It's not clear necessarily that I can recover all information just for the level of small k valued points, right? So, but this is a bijection inducing isomorphisms of residue fields, right, of the corresponding points. Okay, so the basic principle is that you have this space of arcs of Z inside the space of arcs of X, and you should think of this as something very small, right? In some sense, that can be made precise. It has measure zero inside the big set. And outside of the small locus, F infinity is, in fact, a bijection, right? So this will be very powerful in allowing us to relate things downstairs to things upstairs. All right, so once you write it, it's pretty straightforward. Okay, so what does this mean, actually? So the statement is that if I have some field k over small k, right, so I have capital K valued points on the small subset, on the target are in bijection with the k valued points on the source. So suppose that I have, right, so given gamma from spec k of t to x, which lies in, so which does not lie in j infinity z, right? So I need to show that it can be lifted uniquely to y. Right, but then let's write the usual diagram. So I have the map x. So this is y. So I have f. So in here, I have this x minus z. And f, of course, so y minus f inverse of z. So this is an isomorphism. And now let's look at. Let's go to the function field, spec k of t. Right, so the point is that, so what do I know? I know that this arc does not lie completely inside z, so this means that the generic point in here goes to x minus z. Right, so this factors like this, through x minus z. But since this is an isomorphism, this gives me a map this way. Right, so then you get the usual diagram, right, such that the evaluative criterion for properness tells you precisely that this map lifts uniquely, right? So then the evaluative criterion for properness implies that gamma has a unique lift that goes from spec k of t to y. Okay? So that's the proof. All right, so I'll explain a consequence of this proposition. But first of all, let me make one parenthesis before going further. So one remark is that if I'm interested only in the space of arcs of X as a set, right, as a topological space, it doesn't matter whether I change the scheme structure on X. For example, if I replace X by the reduced scheme structure, right? So I have, if I look at X with the reduced scheme structure, and I map to J infinity X by the map induced by inclusion, so this is a homeomorphism. Right, so this is a triviality. So basically, the point is that, I guess, since the formal power series ring is a domain, So of course, if I have a map from spec K of T to X, actually this factors through the reduced scheme structure. So there is, of course, some information that is lost in the process. For example, if I want to understand something about the scheme structure of the space of arcs. But most of what we know how to do at this point cannot deal with this scheme structure anyway. So most of the time, I think almost all of the time, basically we just deal with this as a set, okay, as a topological space. And similarly, for example, if, so this is one remark, and then if the same kind of argument tells us that if I look at the irreducible decomposition of X, so then I get J infinity of X is just J infinity of X1 union J infinity of XR. Again, as sets, as topological spaces. Again, this is, again, because the former power series ring is a domain, right? So a map that maps into X has to map actually inside of one of the irreducible components. So the picture, by the way, gets completely different if instead of working with J infinity, you work with JM, right? So then JM X is actually, I mean, very sensitive to what scheme structure I take on X, right? So if I have some sort of infinitesimal thickening of X, then JM certainly will see that part. But this is just an assertion about the space of arcs. All right, so now a corollary of this proposition, which is in fact the theorem due to Kolchin, is that if X is irreducible, well, let's say if X is a variety, as I said that I don't care about the non-reduced structure, then J infinity X is irreducible. So this is one of the starting points in differential algebra. All right, so maybe I'll prove this just because the idea in the proof is actually very related with what I'm going to talk about in terms of the in connection with the Nash problem. So let's prove the statement. So by the way, so a remark is that this is false in characteristic. So let's prove it. Okay, so one thing I want to do is I want to use two things. I want to use first the proposition, and second, the fact that we know this in one case. Right? So I claim that we know this when X is in fact smooth. Right? So. Is smooth. And this is simply because in that case, right, we saw that every JMX is in fact a smooth variety, right? So if I take the projective limit, then this will still be, if you want to think of the level of rings, right, you have a direct limit of domains, this is still a domain. Right, so the idea is now we'll do induction. Dimension. I guess you start maybe in dimension zero when it's trivial, right? It's just a point. So now let's take a resolution of singularities. So f from y to x, right? So this is, let me remind you, right, so this is proper birational. And y is smooth. All right, so the idea is that what I want to claim is that, in fact, the map at the level of arcs is dominant. So let's consider f infinity
going from j infinity y
x. So we know that this is, well, so we know that this is irreducible. Hence,
it is enough to show that f infinity is dominant.
Okay. As I said, we know that most things actually lift. Right? So by proposition one,
we know that, well, so j infinity x is equal to
the image
of f infinity union with j infinity of z.
Right, so if I want to conclude, it's enough to show that j infinity of z is contained in the closure of the left-hand side. All right, so this is,
of course, irreducible. All
right, so to conclude,
it is enough to show that j infinity of z is contained in the closure of the image of f.
And this will follow by induction. And here is where I use essentially the fact that I'm in characteristic zero. I guess I already used the resolution of singularities, but at least we hope that that's true also in characteristic P. All right, so let's write. So let
z equal to z1 union with zr be the irreducible decomposition.
Z. Right, so as I said, this says that j infinity of z
is the union of this j infinity of the zrs. And now by induction,
each
space of arcs of the zrs is irreducible.
Okay, so it would be enough to find an open subset which actually can be lifted. And now let's choose, so let
for each I, let's choose Wi to be an irreducible component of the inverse image of Zi such that Wi subjects onto zero. Also, this is subjective.
All right. Okay, so now the issue to keep in mind is that this is definitely not birational, right? So I cannot use proposition one. On the other hand, what I can use generic smoothness. Since I'm in characteristic zero, so this is generically smooth. Right, and therefore I can find
open subsets, let's say ui inside wi and vi in here such that this is smooth and subjective.
All right. Okay, but now you remember that there is the criterion for smoothness, the infinitesimal criterion for smoothness, right? Which says that if I have any smooth surjective map, right? So if I have an arc on Vi, since the map is surjective, I can always lift the closed point, and then I can lift the whole arc, right? So since
this is smooth, so this implies that J infinity Ui mapping to J infinity VR is subjective.
right? But so now I'm done, right? So this implies that
J infinity of ZI, which is the closure of J infinity of VI, is contained inside the image, the closure of the image.
Okay. So that's a proof of Colchin's theorem. So of course there are also other proofs that don't use resolution of singularities. But on the other hand, I think that this is the most transparent. Any questions? All right, so now let me say a few words about what's coming. Right? So as I said, we are interested somehow in how much information we can get about the singularities of X by looking at the spaces of jets and the spaces of arcs of X. Right? So the first part having to do with the Nash problem is actually to look at the space of arcs of X. So
this will be the third part, so it's the introduction to the Nash problem.
This definitely is very false for GM. So it's very rare, I mean. Well, so for example, what's known is that if you have a complete intersection, these GMs are irreducible if and only if you have rational singularities. So just take, for example, the cone over whichever it is. No, the first one that's not.
Can you just take a curve. Similar curve and look at that one?
That's right, so that's the simplest. I think for curves, you see right away that unless the curve is smooth, actually, it's always true. Just by considerations of dimensions, right? So for example, if you look at the tangent space, I mean, the tangent space over the smooth locus has dimension 2, and just the fiber over the singular point has dimension 2, so it cannot be. All right. Okay, so again, here the idea is to look at irreducible components, but you cannot look at irreducible components for J infinity of X because we know that there is only one, so that's not very interesting. The idea is to look at the inverse image over the singular locus and see what you can say about those irreducible components. All right, so if
Z inside X is closed, I'll write J infinity Z of X to be the inverse image. It's the inverse image of Z by the map from J infinity X to X. Right?
So they are arcs that are centered at Z. Right? So the center, the closed point, is in Z. Right? So in what follows,
so now I'll take Z to be the singular locus of X.
All right, so basically, Nash's idea
is to consider the irreducible components of this locus, J infinity ZX, and relate them to resolution of singularities.
All right, so here's the first version, which is slightly different than the usual statement. So the idea is let's try to imitate what we did, for example, for the proof of Colchin's theorem. So one thing to remember is, for example, what happens if X is smooth, right? So if X is smooth and if I take some subset inside X, and if I take its inverse image in the space of arcs, because all these projection maps are locally trivial, the inverse image of something irreducible is again irreducible. Right? So we understand what happens in the smooth case. So let's just compare this locus with what happens in a resolution. Right? So let's choose.
F from y to x to be a resolution of singularities.
And I think for my purpose, what I'll want, let's say, I can always assume that such that, remember that z is the singular locus, so I can assume that f is an isomorphism over x minus z. Okay, so. Maybe I'll state second proposition, which says that, first of all, that J infinity Z of X has finitely many irreducible components. Well, so let me emphasize that this is not trivial, right? Because, I mean, we deal with maybe I should have emphasized, right? So, for example, what is the space of arcs of An, or let's say even A1, right? So you saw that the space of M jets of A1 is AM plus 1, right? So this is spec of a polynomial ring in infinitely many variables, right? So this is very much not the finite type.
Over k.
And this, I mean, this leads to a lot of strange and interesting phenomena, right? So one always has to be careful when working in this sort of setting. So the objects are schemes, but are schemes over some very big rings, I mean, corresponding to non-Noetherian rings. All right, but anyway, the statement is that this has finitely many irreducible components, and
each of these components is not contained in J infinity of Z.
Also remember, if you think back about proposition one, we saw that somehow the space of arcs of the singular locus is the locus on which you don't really understand how to go upstairs. But if you are outside of this, then we know that the map F infinity is a bijection. Right? So in particular, for example, what this says is that the generic point of each irreducible component lies outside. So in particular, there is only one thing upstairs above it. Right? So in particular, this will, before we prove this,
in particular, proposition one implies that there is a unique closed subset. Given an irreducible component of Z, there is a unique closed irreducible, W in an irreducible component
of what?
Of this locus J infinity Z of X. There is a unique irreducible subset in J infinity of Y such that F infinity maps W dominantly onto this
irreducible.
Equal to this irreducible component. Okay.
In fact, the proof of the proposition will make this more precise. Will tell you actually what this W is. Okay. So the proof. So maybe let's see. So do I want to do it? So let me explain right, where this comes from. So the idea is very similar to the proof of Kolchin's theorem. Right, so again, we have this resolution of singularities, right? So we know that by proposition one, we have that J infinity Z of y. Right, so again, so I have the arcs centered at Z. Again, some of them, I don't know what happens. For example, this set contains J infinity of Z. Right, so I have to keep track of these guys. And then I have the ones that lie outside, and we know that they can be lifted uniquely. So this is union with F infinity. All right, so what should I put here? So these are the arcs on, I think of the notation. Please complain. All right. So I have here the arcs whose center on X lies in Z. So this means that the center on Y lies in F inverse of Z. All right, so this is J infinity F inverse of Z of Y. OK? All right, so now I know that F inverse of Z is, I can write F inverse of Z as a union of some irreducible components. Let's say W1, WS. So this is the irreducible decomposition. So this implies that J infinity F inverse of Z of Y is the union of J infinity WI of Y, I from 1 up to S. And these guys are all irreducible. Right? Again, this is the statement that since Y is smooth, the projection maps are all locally trivial. So if I take the inverse image of something irreducible upstairs, it's again irreducible. So this part is well understood. So then I have to deal with the space of arcs of Z. Right? But exactly as we did for the proof of Kolchin's theorem, this is will be contained in the closure of this set. So maybe I'm not going to rewrite the same argument. So as in the proof of Kolchin's theorem, we see that J infinity of Z is contained in the closure of the other set. J infinity, F inverse of Z. All right, so basically what this says is that the only reducible components come from these ones. All right, so the conclusion, hence every irreducible component of this locus J infinity Z of X is equal to some F infinity of J infinity WI of Y. And now it's easy to see that this is not contained in the space of arcs of the singular locus. Since J infinity WI of Y is not contained in J infinity of F inverse of Z, which is the assertion is that, in general, if I have a smooth variety and if I take some, for example, some hypersurface, there is always an arc centered at the hypersurface, but which goes outside of the hypersurface, right? So this is actually very easy to check. So this implies that when I push forward this thing, no irreducible component of this locus, J infinity, Z of X, is contained in J infinity of Z. Okay, so this proves the proposition. Okay, so let's see what's the upshot of this. we get
an injective map
that goes from the irreducible components of this locus, J infinity Z of X, to the irreducible components of F inverse of Z. Right? Such that, right? So this is given precisely if I have an irreducible component here, I'm choosing the irreducible component here. Right, so let's see. So if I have, A here. So this goes to WI such that F infinity, J infinity WI of Y dominates this A. Okay? So it's obviously injective, right? Because I can recover A from this locus. So this is one version of the Nash map. The only unpleasant issue is that, right, it depends on the resolution. So let's try. I'm almost out of time, but just take 5 more minutes. All right, so actually what we want is a version independent of resolution. Okay? So the key definition here is the notion of essential divisor. Right, so remember that I think in several talks before, there was this notion that appeared of divisorial valuation that plays an important role, right? So a divisorial valuation, or I guess people in birational geometry call it a divisor over X, a divisor E over X, that you should think of either as you have some birational model Y on X over X, which is normal, and E is some divisor on that model. But you identify two things if they give you the same valuation. So this is essential if the following condition holds. If for every F from Y to X, which is a resolution, which is an isomorphism over X minus Z. Well, so ideally what you would like to say is that, for example, if you can assume that the exceptional locus of this map is a divisor, you want to say that E definitely has to show up. In general, we know that you can find resolution such that this is not true. It's not true that, for example, that the exceptional locus has pure codimension 1. So it's natural to put the condition as saying that the center on Y of E, right, so the image of the divisor on Y is an irreducible component of F inverses. So there are other versions in which, for example, you always put the condition, this condition, only when you assume that F inverse of Z is a divisor and so on. There are various variations. Okay, so for example, I mean, there is a trivial case to keep in mind. For example, so E, you can think of, so you should really think of E as a divisorial valuation of the function field of X. Right? So in practice, what you do is you choose, I mean, it appears as a divisor on some W over X, which is birational over X, and this is a divisor over there. All right, so now what we get, this Nash map going from irreducible components of J infinity Z of X to essential divisors . All right, so here's what you do, right? So you choose given, let's say, A in here, right? Let
f from y to x be a resolution of singularities, which is an isomorphism over x minus z, and such that, so now I'm going to assume that f inverse of z is a divisor.
Right, so for example, I first blow up z, and then I take the resolution of singularities.
So then the previous version, right, tells me that I get a distinguished irreducible component of f inverse of z. So this will be a divisor. So this is the divisor that I'm taking. Such that
n of A is the irreducible component of f inverse of z given
by the previous construction. All right, so now it's straightforward to see that that this is independent on the resolution.
So it's easy that this is independent of resolution. And in fact, the image indeed consists, image is an essential divisor. So let me explain this and then conclude. So
since it's independent on the resolution, right, I can, basically the picture that I need to understand is the following. So I have y to x, I have f, and let's say I have some y prime, and I just know that this is a resolution of singularities, which is an isomorphism over f inverse of z, right? So like in the previous setup. So what I want to prove that the center of E on y prime is an irreducible component of the inverse image of z. Right, but what do I know? I know that I have this, so let's say, so this is the irreducible component, let's say E. Right, so I have G and H. So I have the map H infinity of J infinity of J infinity E of Y. Right, so this, if I take the closure, so this will be a closed subset in the space of arcs of y prime. And by construction, it dominates this irreducible component A. Because of uniqueness, right? So this has to be equal to J infinity of some W of y prime for some irreducible component W of G inverse of Z. All right, so this is what we know. We know that if I have a closed irreducible subset which maps to the irreducible component A that I started with, right, so that is of the form J infinity W of Y prime. But this forces clearly that, in fact, W is actually the image H of E. Right? So in particular, what this says is that the center of E on y prime is an irreducible component. Right? So this implies that the center on y prime of E is an irreducible component of G inverse of Z. All right, so Nash's question is an bijective. Right, so of course, because the other map is bijective, this is clear, sorry, the other map was injective, so this is injective. So the question is an bijective if X is a surface? It's straightforward to check that this is okay for curves. And the problem has a very interesting history because Nash, I think, wrote it in the 60s. And then
The paper never got published. And in the 90s, after Nash got the Nobel Prize, I mean, he got in the spotlight, and there was a conference for him, and then there was this volume that was published in which the paper appeared. But I think that, of course, Hironaka was aware of Nash's question, and he gave the problem to his students. So Monique Lejeune-Jalabert worked a lot on it, and then her student, Anna Reguera. And anyway, so now this is all settled, so we'll hear more this afternoon about it. So, okay, I'm sorry I went over time. So you can take off my 10 minutes from the second talk. So. Thank you very much.